Hi, this is Tom Pins with the Palo Alto Networks community team. In this week's video tutorial, I'm going to explain U-Turn NAT and how to configure and test it. We'll go over what U-Turn NAT is, when it can be useful, and how to configure and test it. What is U-Turn NAT? The term U-Turn NAT is used when the logical path of a connection traverses a firewall from inside to outside and back in, by connecting to an internal resource using its external IP address. U-Turn NAT is a configuration trick to accommodate a deployment where the external IP address needs to be used to reach an internal resource. So when can U-Turn NAT be useful? In some environments, an internal host may require an external IP address to run a certain service, for example, a locally hosted web server or mail server. Internal hosts may need to use the external IP address due to the absence of an internal DNS server or other requirements specific to that service. In the default configuration, we only have a destination NAT configured. This means that any session started from the laptop directly at the public IP address of the web server is going to be translated to the web server's internal IP address without doing any source translation. This means that a packet sent from the laptop will go to the firewall, will be translated into the web server's internal IP address and forwarded to the web server, and then the web server is going to reply directly to the laptop. The web server's reply packet will be discarded by the client, as the source IP address of the packet is the web server's physical IP address instead of the public one. With U-Turn NAT properly configured, any packets coming from the client going to the web server's public IP address will not only be translated to the web server's internal IP, but the source IP address will also be changed into the firewall's internal interface IP address, causing the web server to reply to the firewall. This will allow the firewall to apply a reverse NAT and will prevent the client from discarding the reply packet, as the source IP address will now match the original outbound packet. Next, we'll take a look at how to configure U-Turn NAT. We'll first take a look at a configuration without U-Turn NAT. In the security policy, we have a simple inbound rule that allows anyone from the internet to connect to the web server on application web browsing. And there's a simple outbound rule that allows anyone from the local network out to the internet. If you take a look at the NAT policy, we'll see that there's an inbound policy where the original packet can be from any zone distant to the public IP address of the web server, which is located in the untrust zone, to be translated to 192.168.0.97, which is the physical IP address of the web server, and the simple outbound NAT policy that's going to hide anyone from the internal network going out to the internet to be hidden behind the IP address of the firewall. With this configuration active, if we take a look at the client PC and open up a web browser that points to the public IP address of the web server, you're going to notice that the page is going to keep loading. Nothing's going to happen. If you open up the wire server running in the background, we'll see that the client IP address is sending out packets to the public IP address of the web server, but reply packets are being received by the private IP address of the web server. Since the client is not aware it's setting up a session with the private IP address, it's going to send the reset packet and keep trying until it eventually times out. If we go back to the firewall, we can now go ahead and create a U-turn policy. In the NAT policy, we will create a new rule. We'll call this one internal access. The original packet, the source zone, is going to be trust. The destination zone is still going to be untrust because the IP address of the destination is going to be the public IP address of the web server, 198.51.30. In the translated packet, we're going to set up destination translation to the internal IP address of the web server, but we're also going to enable source translation. We're going to take dynamic IP import, the address type we're going to bind to the internal interface of the firewall. And we can go ahead and create a rule. It might appear at the bottom. We need to make sure that it's located above the inbound policy, because else this policy will still take precedence over the new one. We can now go ahead and commit this. And now we can go back to the client and see if anything has changed. If you now take another look at the client laptop and open up the web page, we'll see that it loads as expected. If you take a look at Wireshark, we'll see that the client is sending out packets to the public IP address of the web server, and is also receiving packets back from the public IP address. I hope you enjoyed watching this video tutorial. Thank you for watching.